Because thank you for allowing me to contribute to the discussions on the ministerial salaries, a topic many Singaporeans feel strongly about and one which has deeper implication on Singapore's political future than some may imagine. So in 2007, the last time Parliament had this debate on the revision of ministerial salaries, I disagreed with the benchmark formula that the government used at that time. I considered it unrealistic to peg minister salaries to just the top 48% of people who change from year to year, since this is too small a group and variations may not be reflective of changes of salaries of the first 48 people used in the benchmark. I also said in 2007 that the Prime Minister should do away with the benchmark and just use the base salary of 1.2 million, which was set in 1994, to determine future salary increases. Just as a company which has a one-time exercise to determine remuneration policy philosophy, I thought that we, after more than a decade of having a salary at that level, we had something that worked well for Singapore. So the 2007 adjustment was a difficult one to accept, as salaries at that time jumped based on the unrealistic benchmark formula used. I'm therefore happy that this has now been corrected to a more realistic level and which is more reflective of what it should be. While I still feel that it is not wise to use the benchmark pegged against the private sector, I can understand the review committee's rationale for doing so. The committee, in fact, looked at different benchmark options, including what the Workers' Party is recommending of using salaries of ministers in other countries before recommending the current formula. The review committee sought to correlate ministers to talent in Singapore and therefore recommended the ministerial salaries to be pegged at the top 1,000 income earners here. I feel that by expanding the pool to benchmark against the 1,000 income earners here, it is a lot more palatable than just the 48 people that we were using in the past. At least at the 1,000 people level, we may statistically better capture the various variants of salaries of Singapore top talent from year to year. However, even this time, the committee suggests a 40% discount to the median salary of the top 1,000 earners, reflecting the difficulty of finding the right benchmark formula, as it was previously put at 2/3 of the benchmark. But I agree with many Singaporeans that it is not useful to talk about a discount as a measure of public service and sacrifice. And moreover, the discount figure of 40% is based on a perception that it reflects accurately the level of discount that should be given to public service. This is arbitrary and subjective. I understand, though, that the review committee suggested this approach in absence of any standard formula or convention that can be logically applied to this scenario of ministers doing their jobs both as a national service as well as a career. This is therefore a much better approach as compared to what the Workers' Party is suggesting. In fact, what the Workers' Party is suggesting, that we peg the salary to the divisional director level, which is about $10,000, which is what is being used in some of the 12 countries that they mentioned. But I think we cannot give a partial solution, because in most of these 12 countries that the Workers' Party is comparing against, there are also a whole bunch of perks and allowances that are used to determine the final salary of an MP, which is then used to determine the final salary and allowance of a minister. And I looked at most of the countries that were suggested by the Workers' Party, and guess what? None of them has a clean wage system. They have many allowances and perks, some hidden perks. For example, in Japan, where MPs and ministers get to rent a house in a prime district at about 1/5 of the market value. And also, in addition to that, all the rest of the allowances that we know about, medical allowance, housing allowance, and a whole bunch of others. So therefore, I think if the Workers' Party wanted a formula, they should have talked about everything and not just give us a partial solution to compare against. Actually, the discount proposed may not have been necessary, as a principle of paying our ministers and civil servants high salaries is not a flawed one. It is better to pay them a clean wage without any perks, as I mentioned before. In 2007, I agreed with this principle, and I'll say today, again, that I support it. Many quote examples of leaders from other countries who do not earn as high salaries as our leaders. However, what they miss is that leaders from other countries get everything else. The perks that I mentioned, cars, home, servants, food items, paid in addition to their salaries. In fact, I learned that in the UK, that ministers and MPs also get motorcycle and bicycle allowances in addition to mileage allowances for the transport that they use. So our ministers earn a clean wage, which means that every other expense is borne personally by them through these salaries. But nonetheless, intrigued by what the Workers' Party was recommending, I looked at some of the examples. And I take Britain as an example where a cabinet minister has a salary entitlement of about £135,000 in addition to the salary allowance of an MP of about £65,000. And then there's a whole slew of other allowances, staffing expenditure, communications expenditure, admin and office expenditure, IT equipment, London course allowance, London accommodation allowance, personal additional accommodation allowance, constituency office allowance. And this does not include things like chauffeur-driven cars in the range of Jaguars for many cabinet ministers and those who claim mileage allowances, and also the whole range of pension and medical benefits that they get. Just taking what could be accounted for, I added this to be £411,000, which is about $815,000. So I don't think paying our ministers what we pay is overly high. So in France, in addition to a salary and number of allowances like what the UK MPs and ministers get, they also get free train and plane travel and also an unaudited expense allowance. The French president of the French Senate commands an undisclosed, virtually uncontrolled expense budget, which is about £2.2 million per year, much higher than the ministers, our ministers get. And on a purchasing power parity basis or PPP, India pays the most to their MPs, while Japan, Italy, and Singapore pay about the same level. And in some other countries, and these countries I mentioned, their unofficial income of MPs and ministers is a lot more higher than the official amount. And if you want to have an internationally comparable standard, I think a good measure would be to look at the GDP per capita on a price PPP basis. This ratio is about 35 for US. And for most Western Europe and Japan, it is about 10 times for an MP. In Singapore, at a PPP GDP of about $59,000 and an MP allowance of $192,000, our ratio is 3.2, which is not overly generous in my opinion. So I agree with the general view that salary should not be an incentive to lure or to attract talent into public service. However, it should also not be a disincentive. We want men and women to come forward to serve the country and not to be tempted by high salaries to join. But at the same time, we cannot deny that holding political office is a great responsibility which has deep impact on the daily lives of Singaporeans and the future of the country. With Singapore being a small and open economy, we are often vulnerable to a whole bunch of external factors that are beyond our control. And it's not easy for ministers to steer Singapore. The salaries ministers earn could reflect the responsibility and significance of their jobs. So even some of the CEOs of SMEs who I know these days earn more than what the committee has recommended for our ministers at the entry level, let alone the CEOs of large listed companies. I hope that Singaporeans appreciate that our ministers should be getting paid a level which would pay for a good person to do a top job, regardless of whether it is in the private sector or the civil service or in government. Based on this principle, I feel that the current level proposed is not an overly generous one. And I'm glad that the main opposition party in this House, the Workers' Party, has agreed to this level of salary based on the computation that Mr. Chen proposed, 5 times to 9 times of an MP. And this further supports my point that we should do away with a benchmark for future, that we already have, all of us, the government and the opposition has agreed that we have a good base to start from, and the Prime Minister should in the future use this as a basis to determine future salaries and not be caught in a benchmarking exercise that can be quite emotional. However, where I do advocate high salaries, I would also like to see more accountability for mistakes and problems created as a result of a minister's poor performance. If we can peg our minister's salary to top income earners in Singapore, then likewise, we also should have high standards of accountability of performance. And so I hope the Prime Minister will be quick to take to task a minister who may perform poorly. And if a minister consistently performs poorly and less than satisfactorily, the Prime Minister should be quick to replace him, as is done in the private sector with CEOs. Here is where the new bonus structure recommended by the review committee can play an important role, as it could be used as a useful tool to reward good performers, and conversely, the Prime Minister may also use it to send a strong signal to a minister if his performance is less than satisfactory. In this regard, the national bonus is a very good idea, as it's more reflective of the impact of policies on the lives of Singaporeans than the previous GDP bonus. The new structure is tilted towards the improvements of life of a good cross-section of Singaporeans, and I commend the review committee for listening to the feedback about how the GDP bonus was too general and therefore not a good measure for a performance bonus. I also support the recommendation to remove pensions, as this now normalises the pay structure of ministers with most of other Singapore government jobs. But we must recognise and appreciate that this is a huge loss of compensation to the ministers in addition to the salary cuts. So whatever formula we suggest, we will face similar questions. It is therefore that we exercise judgment of whether what the committee has recommended as a compensation for our ministers as fair and fix our own Singapore-based salary structure, which will not require a benchmarking exercise in the future. I therefore disagree with the proposal for a review every 5 years, as 5 years is too short a time, and it will not be a productive exercise at each time we keep raising the same issues over and over again. Perhaps a new Prime Minister in each era may want to review the structure, but I don't agree with a review every 5 years. What each Prime Minister can do before he hands over to the next Prime Minister is to decide on good bonuses in good years and for good performance, and temporary salary cuts in bad years and for poor performers. This is what we do in the private sector, not to review the philosophy or salary structures each time there's a need to adjust salaries. So in conclusion, while we should not talk about sacrifice and discounts, the recommendations by the committee reflect huge reduction in compensation for our political office holders. We will never find the perfect comparable benchmark to compare with, not the private sector, not with ministers in other countries, but we must believe that the extensive review exercise by the committee has identified the appropriate level of compensation for our ministers. And this time, the Workers' Party, the main opposition in this House, has agreed to the level proposed. In the past, in fact, they had disagreed. And this time, I'm happy to note that they've agreed to this. So let's use this as our base for future determination of salaries. With these changes, I hope we'll continue to see good men and women attracted to public office to serve Singapore, even with this new salary structure. I'm sure we will be able to attract those who are already successful in their careers and who have been at the prime of their careers for some time, and with the will to do national service. However, we also recruit talent based on potential, and I worry about our ability to attract such people with the potential to serve, but who have not yet reached the prime and peak of their careers, especially in these times of much greater public scrutiny, as mentioned by Mr. Sam Tan just now. So with this, I generally support the recommendations made by the Review Committee on Ministerial Salaries, and I hope that all of us can accept this and move on and not reopen this from year to year. Thank you.
Mr. Pritam Singh, you have a clarification.
The member spoke about the point of a clean wage. Under the committee's proposals, the bonus that can be accrued by ministers is up to 13.5 months. Does the member think that a clean wage ought to include such a high amount of bonus? Because I'm sure it's more than getting an allowance for riding a motorcycle or a bicycle.
Sir, I support a level of bonus even higher than the 13.5% if the minister deserves it. 35 months if the minister did it. In 2008-09, when we faced a terrible financial crisis, I think Mr. Tharman Shanmugaranam as finance minister should have got a much higher bonus than what he may have got. In the private sector, I think, contrary to the issue raised by Mr. Giam, it is not 2 or 3 months bonus. Even in a small company that I know of, last year, a person at a middle level had about 10 to 11 months of bonus, where the CEO had about 15 months of bonus. And in the financial sector, they're even higher than that. So the 13.5 is not an overly high number. It is something that is required to reward talent for a good job that they do.
Yes, Mr. Singh.
So I just to confirm the clarification, the member is saying that a 13.5-month bonus, or even more than that, actually does not contradict the clean wage proposal put forward by the committee. Am I right to say that?
It does not contradict, because minister salaries are reported every year in the budget book, and I think there is also a recommendation for the Prime Minister to share with the House on a yearly basis what ministers have been paid. So it is declared. What is not clean is if the 13.5 was not declared and the formula for determining that is not declared. Now, there is a very clear formula on how a minister can achieve the 13 or whatever bonus that he's entitled to based on very clear parameters. And this is, in fact, an excellent way of measuring performance that is very objective. It's not subjective at all.